Friends, you are welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Professor Balramulu, retired from Kakatiya University, Warangal, Telangana state. And I have three decades of experience, both in teaching and research. Then I published number of books on public policy and published number of articles. And I was also a recipient of several awards like National Fellow ICSR, UGC Emeritus Fellow. Now today we'll discuss about the public globalization and public policy. Now in this we need to keep in mind two important factors, globalization and public policy, and another one is the relationship between the globalization and the public policy. Now coming to the globalization. Now globalization, If you try to understand the definition, there is nothing like a single definition. But if you wanted to understand the globalization process, it's a process of an economic activity that is being operated not only in one country, but in several other countries. And if you trace out the history of the globalization in our own country, now it started from East India Company. East India Company visited this particular country and operated their economic activity not only in our country but in several other countries also. And this globalization process got more prominence, particularly after the end of the Cold War. In the sense, that is from 1989 onwards. In the year 1989, there was a Washington Consensus. John William proposed Washington Consensus, wherein he proposed 10 policy prescriptions. Now, 10 policy prescriptions is not only meant for a particular country, but entire world. But as student of public policy, we need to keep in mind that this policy, these 10 policies are not really suitable to all other countries, because the countries vary from in its economic conditions, social conditions, and political conditions. So therefore, globalization is basically an economic activity in not only one country, but several other countries. The second issue that we need to keep in mind is the public policy. What is public policy? Public policy, according to David Easton, it says that it is an authoritative allocation of values and resources for the entire country, for the whole society. And Thomas Day defines that what the government should do, what government should not do, is public policy. And in our own country, we have been undertaking number of public policies right from 1947 to even today. Now, the students we need to keep in mind while discussing this particular topic, that is, it's not simply what is globalization, what is policy, public policy. We need to discuss the relationship between the globalization and the public policy.
Now, with regard to the globalization and the public policy, first let us discuss about the context of globalization. Globalization is a term in heavy current usage, but one whose meaning remains difficult, often even among those who invoke it. Indeed, John Ott states that globalization stands out for quite a large public spread across the world as one of the defining terms of late 20th century social consciousness. The term is often distinguished more by what it is not rather than what it is. James Rosenway recognized such a tendency when he stated that globalization is not the same as globalism, which points out to aspirations for an end state of affairs wherein values are shared by or pertinent to all the world's 5 billion people, their environment, their roles as citizens, consumers or producers, with an interest in collective action designed to solve common problems, nor it is a universalism, values which embrace all humanity hypothetically or actually. Then coming to the economic context of globalization, alternatively, globalization might be characterized functionally by essentially related series of economic phenomena. These include the liberalization and deregulation of markets, privatization of assets, retreat of state functions, particularly welfare ones, diffusion of technology, cross-national distribution of manufacturing production, foreign direct investment, and the integration of capital markets. In its narrowest formulation, The term refers to the worldwide spread of sales, production, facilities, and manufacturing process, all of which reconstitute the internal national division of labor. Many analysts suggest that we have witnessed prior periods of globalization, or that this is a culmination of an extended process. Critically, however, many of these people are economists whose discussion is particularly narrow in its application. Often, globalization is considered condensed into a discussion of whether national income, as measured largely in terms of growth, is converging or diverging. Relatively, considerations of the appropriateness of one or another indicator as a measure of convergence ends up taking precedence over the broader consideration. J.G. William, noted Harvard economist and then president of the Economic History Association, also argued in his presidential address that globalization leads to convergence and has done in prior historical periods. The substance of this argument, he said, was that the critical bottom line for me is whether the living standard gap between the rich and the poor countries falls over time. Convergence implies an erosion of this gap, at least in the percentage terms. The spirit of this kind of response is reflected in the approach adopted by others, such as R.J. Barry Jones, who suggests that globalization may simply be an intensification of the process of international interdependence, a function of growth of competition in an international free trade system intensified by the diffusion of technology. It is therefore a function of increase in the density and complexity of international interactions. Jones characterizes globalization as a complex, layered, interconnected, and uneven. It is reflected in a quantitative growth in the volume and internationalization of finance, production, and economic transitions. The intensification of these processes has a qualitative change in the pattern of constraints and opportunities facing actors, particularly states. There is also another approach, particularly the American approach. Globalization represents the universalizing American values based on a normative, indeed a moral foundation. In modernization literature, the convergence is towards liberal democracy and modernity, defined as industrialized economic development, one that involves characteristics feature of limited state apparatus. But its specific form of liberal democracy, it is John Locke's and not Jean's Rousseau's variant, and it is comparably a particular form of economic development. What Mawlana may be correct in suggesting that globalization has brought more surface homogenization than the fundamental change. He still concedes that it offers the prospects of American culture, which he describes as entertainment, fashion, and the American way of life, in some commercial secularism. Now, it is strange that the Marxist analysis concurs mostly with the views expressed above. This comes in two variations, both stressing on the distributive economic effects of the increasingly unfettered capitalism unleashed by globalization, rather than its democratizing and productive economic influences. The first largely tracks the debate between the Lenin and Kausik, contemplating the role of structure and the capacity for reform in the capitalist system. Whether underdevelopment is endemic and a convergence towards universalization of imperialism exported from the advanced industrialized countries is inevitable in an era of unregulated capitalism. Lenin said remarkably little about variants in forms of capitalism in a discussion of imperialism, encouraging the notion that variations were little significance. The strand of Marxism therefore defines the new globalization period as accentuation of the prior period, a continued epoch of capitalism. A second variant of the Marxist argument turns to Gramsci for its intellectual base. Epistemized by the work of Stephen Gill, this formulation emphasizes the notion of formation of transition class that constitute part of the historic bloc. Coming to the second aspect of our discussion, that is public policy, if you look at the background, epistemologically, the term policy comes to us from Greek and Latin languages. Greek root polis, the city or the city-state, evolved into Latin politia, the state, and the latter into the Middle English polis, which referred to the conduct of public affairs or the administration of government. The epistemological origins of a policy are the same for two or other important words, polis and politics. The essence of public administration is policy making. Policies are vital for planning a course of action. They supply necessary guidelines which help in planning, implementing, and realizing the desired objectives and in keeping the activities of the objective within the prescribed framework of action. Policies thus give meaning and form the object. Although the public policy has been a major concern of social scientists and the general public for a long time, there is a considerable disagreement over what public policy is and what it is not. There are two standard definitions of public policy, one broader and the other one is narrower. Narrower definition of public policy focuses on the direct impact of specific governmental decision. The more comprehensive definition includes the governmental and non-governmental factors influencing those decisions. The term policy is a course of action adopted and pursued by government, party, etc. Any course of action adopted and pursued as advantageous. David Easton defines policy as outputs of the political system and the public policy as the authoritative allocation of values for the whole society. Anderson suggests that policy be regarded as a relative stable, purposive course of action followed by an actor or set of actors in dealing with the problem or matter of concern. For Parson, a policy is an attempt to define and structure a rational basis for action or inaction. Public policies are the policies adopted and implemented by government bodies and officials. Public policies are formulated by what Easton calls the authorities in a political system. Many elders, paramount chiefs, executives, legislatures, judges, administrators, counselors, monarchs, and the like. According to him, these are the persons who engage in the daily affairs of a political system and are recognized by most members of the system as having responsibility for these matters and take actions that are accepted as binding most of the time by the most of the members, so long as they act within the limits of their role. For Dai, public policy is what government chooses to do or not to do. Policies may take various forms such as legislation, executive orders, or other official acts. A policy may be general or specific, broad or narrow, public or private, simple or complex, qualitative or quantitative, discretionary or detailed, explicit and implicit. From the viewpoint of public policies, governmental activities can be classified into two categories, such as those based on definite or specific policies and those based on general, vague and inconsistent policies. Important public policies are often made more explicit, particularly where the issue of a law, a regulation, or a plan and the like is involved. The Supreme Court of India may, through its decisions, give new interpretations to some of the articles of the Constitution, which may amount to a new policy. Further, policies are often too vague or too general and are not always consistent with each other. In a turbulent environment, government departments often have to take immediate action without reference to any specific policy. Public policies are mostly adopted formally by the government authorities. A public policy may also be narrow, covering specific activity, or it may spread to a wider range of apply to all the people in the country. Each level of government may have its specific or general policies. Then there are mega policies. There are general guidelines to be followed by all specific policies. They are kind of master policies according to Drar. According to Drar, mega policies involve determination of the postures, assumptions, and the main guideline to be followed by specific policies. They are kind of master policy, clearly distinct from detailed discrete policies. Though these two pure types of policies are on a continuum with many in-between cases. Now, coming to the interaction between the globalization and the public policy, and more particularly about the globalization and its impact on the public policy. The present process of globalization is moving well beyond the economic fortunes. It is seeking to make inroads into the critical areas of environment, governance, politics, and labor. In a way, this will integrate the diverse political and social system all over the world. In this world, the developing countries, including India, increasingly are to respond to the needs and changes of the emerging world scenario as well as development pattern of developed nations. It is the result of innovations in science and technology and the subsequent social formation. The role of developing countries in shaping the international economic policies and national welfare program consistent with their national needs has been substantially reduced. The initiative that India took this regard during the period from 1950 to 1980 diminished during the end of the 1990s. India was pressurized to adjust not only her international but also national policies to meet the needs of and requirements of the developed countries. In addition, the pace of policy implementation also had to consistent with the demands of developed countries. The institutional structure that was established immediately after the Second World War aimed at bringing consistency between the national policies and global objectives, as well as ensuring predictability and stability in the world economy, is beginning of globalization. This led to attempts to establish international trade organization, which did not fully succeed, but led to signing of contraction general agreement on trade and tariff. This agreement was succeeded by the World Trade Organization. It may be mentioned that GATT, WTO, International Monetary Fund, and the World Bank are also established with the purpose of reshaping international economic order in favor of the advanced countries. While the developed countries found the International Monetary Fund unsuitable to meet their needs, the developing countries, including India, become increasingly dependent on it. The conditionalities prescribed by the IMF increasingly determined the foreign economic relations of borrowing countries. As a result, these developing and transitional economies unilaterally liberalized their economies and created expanded market. This increased the number of countries integrated into the globalized world. The World Bank, though it failed to achieve reconstruction objectives for war of devastated economies, has played a significant role in the welfare policies of developing countries. These two institutions have not only influenced the economic and welfare policies of developing countries, but have also embarked upon making inroads into such critical areas of governance in the name of increasing efficiency and eliminating corruption. Further, the above institutions have often acted as an instrument of US foreign economic policy. After the emergence of WTO, these three institutions, namely IBRD, IMF, and WTO, coordinate the international policies of developing countries to meet the needs of globalization. They can influence the domestic policies of the developing countries, including India. The founders of WTO had emphasized that it would coordinate its activities in close collaboration with IMF and IBRD. In pursuit of this objective, the WTO signed a memorandum of understanding with these two institutions. It is expected that these three institutions will establish a policy regime to meet the demands of globalization in the coming decades. It is important to recognize that globalism is not a new phenomenon. In fact, the world economy experienced this during the 18th and 19th centuries along with the development of capitalism. The First World War and the subsequent economic depression showed the process of globalization. An important feature in the structure of globalization is the growth of transnational corporations and their activities. It is estimated that there are 63,000 parent firms with the around 690,000 foreign affiliations and philanthropic inter-firm arrangements and lead to virtually in all countries in most of their economic activities, rendering transnational corporation as a formidable force in the present world economy. The top 100 non-financial transactional corporations of the world are based almost exclusively in developed countries. They are the principal drivers of international production. The fundamental shifts in the international political economy and the strategic power balances have vastly changed the circumstances in which India had to function. The challenges that Indian policymakers face today is similar to what Jawaharlal Nehru faced in 1947, when the dawn of independence coincided with the beginnings of the Cold War. Nehru succeeded in evolving a policy which gave India diplomatic space in which it was able to retain autonomy of decision so as to pursue its national interest. The accelerated program of neoliberal reform that was adopted in 1991 had two separate but interlinked aspects of structural adjustment. The initial stabilization component aimed at deflating the economy, reducing the rate of growth, and curbing the excessive demands that were being placed on India's limited pool of foreign exchange in order to reduce the balance of payments deficit. Devaluation of the rupee, along with an initial period of import compression ensued with import curbs, was soon substituted deflationary stance that was expected to reduce domestic demand and absorption to levels where the import will be sustainable. However, stabilization was seen as a temporary strategy in as much as the very act of stabilizing the economy was expected to restore international investor confidence, increase access to foreign exchange, and permit a higher rate of growth rate. The structural adjustment program was the inevitable result of this process. Meanwhile, the proposed financial liberalization, which forced the government into more costly forms of marketing borrowing, meant that the cost of servicing any debt contract would be higher. Second, since the tax regime was to be rationalized to do away disincentives to save and invest for the private sector, deficit reduction could not be based on additional resource mobilization, but would mainly involve cuts in expenditure. It is important to bear in mind that these were not inevitable strategies. Rather, they were options that were chosen because of essentially political choices about which groups in society would have to bear the burden of adjustment. Therefore, the neoliberal package of economic reforms aimed at fiscal management increased the burden on masses through the reduced government expenditure. The industrial policy in the post-reform phase has moved into three principal directions. One is removal of capacity controls by de-reserving and de-licensing industries or abolishing the requirement to obtain license to create new capacity or substantially expand the existing capacity. Second, the dilution of provisions of the Monopolies and Restrictive Trade Practices, that is MRTP Act, so as to facilitate the expansion of diversification of large firms belonging to the big business groups. And third is foreign investment regulation. In this direction was the grant of automatic approval or exemption from the case-by-case approval for equity investment of up to 51% and for foreign technology agreements in identified high-priority industries. Subsequently, the Foreign Exchange Regulation Act was modified so that companies with foreign equity exceeding 40% of the total were to be treated on par with the Indian companies. With the growth in the trade and services, a new economy known as knowledge economy emerged, bringing in its wake huge perception in the lives of common masses in India. Economic and trade policies are being made to adjust the country's potential with that of world economy. Skills and capacities have now become the hallmark of a robust economy. This is a country like India with mass illiteracy has created a churning in the livelihoods of rural households. The urban situation is stagnant with the pockets of prosperity and a global appeal. The situation is now one of the metropolitan capitalism.
Friends, let us sum up. Now, the globalization is not a recent phenomenon. Globalization started from the East India Company. And particularly if you look at our own country, the globalization process has increased from 1991 onwards, wherein we adopted new economic reforms policy. As a part of that, we have gone for disinvestment. We also gone for several other reforms, deregulation and other things. Now, because of the globalization, we have to follow the national or global goals and keep the national goals in accordance with the global goals. For instance, sustainable development goals, which are formulated by the UNDP, United Nations Development Fund, and they have formulated about 17 goals. Those goals, they are really, really relevant to all the countries, including India. We also, now today, whether we like it or not, we have to follow those goals. And those goals, sometimes they are very relevant to our own country, but as a student of public policy, we need to keep in mind that the Indian government should have autonomy in formulating the policies. But in today, the Indian government has no autonomy in formulating policies because the resources are globalized, technology is globalized, institutions are globalized, and Indian state has a limited autonomy in formulating the policies. And if you look at the experience of the globalization, the entire globe, now there are countries which are benefited, but in many countries, including advanced countries, they are also facing economic crisis. For example, from 2008 onwards, several European countries, up to in 2011 and other years in the USA. Now, there are several problems, particularly the economic sector. So therefore, globalization is not the panacea. It's not the universal principle, or it will not give the universal policy for addressing the policy problems of our own people. So what we need to keep in mind is, at the end, that is, we need globalized information, globalized assistance, but those information assistance, we need to incorporate in our own policies, and that is the reason the economists or social scientists, they are calling for a new strategy, that is not the globalization, but glocalization. Here, glocalization, I mean both global and local needs. We have to combine both the global issues and the local issues. Then only we have to formulate the policy. Then only public policies will be really effective. Thank you very much.